Good evening, and welcome to tonight's performance in the Music from the Collection series, sponsored by the Harry Ransom Center and the Sarah and Ernest Butler School of Music at the University of Texas. I'm Richard Workman, the Associate Librarian of the Ransom Center, and I'd like to thank you all for coming to tonight's program. And I'd also like to take this opportunity to remind everyone to please turn off your cell phones and pagers. Thank you. Tonight we're bringing you a fascinating program, including a performance of Maurice Ravel's trio for piano, violin, and cello at the hands of pianist Richard Dowling, violinist Daniel Ching, and cellist Amy Levine Sang. We'll begin with a lecture by Richard Dowling titled Maurice Ravel's Trio, Its Historical Background, and a Demonstration of Major Differences Between the Original 1915 Durand Edition and the Ransom Center's 1914 Ravel manuscript. But before I turn the program over to Richard, I'd like to take a few moments to answer the question that I know is foremost in everyone's mind. What is the manuscript of Ravel's trio doing at the University of Texas? Well, here's the tale, and as you'll see, it involves a touch of mystery and intrigue. The story begins with Carlton Lake, who was an American journalist and art critic working in France after World War II. There, he was able to pursue his lifelong passion for collecting all things literary and artistic. Over a period of six decades, he built a major collection of French paintings, photographs, books, and manuscripts. And when it came time for him to select a research university to take over the care and handling of his collection, and to make it available to scholars, he was so impressed with the University of Texas's Humanities Research Center, as it was then called, that he made it the permanent home of his collections, and he became the center's French curator. Today, his manuscript collection represents the largest and most significant accumulation of French literary materials outside of Europe. Once established at the University of Texas, Lake continued to collect, but now on behalf of the center. In his book of memoirs, he recalls that in 1977, he was on the trail of a small cache of early Ravel music manuscripts that he had gotten wind of. His search led him to a musicologist in Paris, whose name he does not divulge. Unfortunately, the musicologist deflated his hopes of acquiring this particular quarry. But where one hope died, another was born, and Lake learned from the musicologist about a much richer cache of music manuscripts that just might be available for purchase. When Lake began to realize the probable extent and importance of this collection, however, he was dismayed. The French government would never let such a treasure leave France. But, said the musicologist, the scores were no longer in France. Oh, said Lake, tell me more. They continued their discussions, and the musicologist promised to pursue the matter on his behalf. Months passed. A phone call came from New York. More information about the collection was conveyed. It was almost too good to be true. Over 90 manuscripts by the finest French composers of the early 20th century. The orchestral and two piano versions of Ducas' Sorcerer's Apprentice, Debussy's ballet Kama, Fauré's orchestral score for Masques and Bergamasques, and the manuscripts of his song cycle Le Jardin Clos and the 13th Barcarolle for piano. Ravel's Gaspard de la Nuit, the Rhapsody Espagnole, the Introduction and Allegro, and the complete orchestral score for his ballet Daphnis and Chloe. Not to mention the manuscripts of 60% of Albert Roussel's complete output. In his memoirs, Lake wrote, there could be only one possible source for this collection, a family that had assembled and held these manuscripts through four generations, the French music publisher Durand. I put the question, the answer was yes. The present owner, however, Lake was not at liberty to reveal. The price asked was $3 million, a little too steep even for the University of Texas back in those heady days. But Carlton Lake was a master of this game, He reasoned that if the price was out of the University of Texas's reach, it was probably out of everyone else's as well. And that proved to be true. So Lake bided his time. More months passed. The anonymous seller got back in touch to explore the possibility of negotiation. New offers were made. Counteroffers came in reply. And finally, the call arrived. You've got yourself a deal. And so the entire collection became a part of what is now the Harry Ransom Center. 8 manuscripts by Ducas, 11 by Fauret, 22 by Ravel, and 50 by Roussel. A total of more than 3,600 pages of manuscript music, all joining the Carlton Lake collection of French manuscripts and all ready for study by scholars. One of the researchers who came along to make use of this trove was a young doctoral student from the UT School of Music named Richard Dowling, who chose to write his thesis on Ravel's manuscript of the trio for piano, violin, and cello. That thesis led to a doctorate of musical arts. Since then, Richard has continued his studies, which have resulted in the publication of scholarly editions of numerous works by Ravel, Debussy, Fauret, Hummel, Mendelssohn, and Gershwin. Last year, Masters Music Publications published his critical performing edition of Ravel's trio, which you'll be hearing tonight. And as if that weren't enough, on top of that, Richard has had an extremely successful career as concert pianist and recording artist. And now I'm going to turn the program over to Richard for the lecture portion of the evening. Would you welcome, please, pianist Richard Dowling.
Goodness gracious, there's so many people here. I can't believe this many people would want to come to an academic lecture. It must be Ravel, not me. Thank you for coming tonight. I hope you find this as interesting as I have for the past 20 years. I've been in love with the Ravel Trio since I first performed it at the Norfolk Chamber Music Festival in Connecticut when I was a student at Yale University. And I think every musician that comes into contact with this piece is overwhelmed by it. It's truly a masterpiece of the chamber music literature, and the university is very fortunate indeed to have it here at the Harry Ransom Center. Ravel's contributions to chamber music are very important, but limited. For him, a certain style of composition was like a puzzle to be solved only once and never again. There is only one Ravel string quartet, and there's only one Ravel piano trio. He composed it in the spring and summer of 1914. He had planned to write a piano trio for many years and had mentioned it to his friends very often. Ravel found it very difficult to compose in Paris, where he lived. There was just too many social distractions there. So in the summers, he returned to his hometown of Saint-Jean-de-Luz, which is a beautiful city on the Atlantic coast, right at the Spanish border, just barely on the French side. And it's part of what's known as the Basque country. On the last page of the Ransom Center manuscript, Ravel signed his name and wrote Saint-Jean-de-Luz, April 3rd, to August 7th, 1914, in French, of course. In 1913, Ravel conceived of the idea to compose a one-movement piano concerto entitled Zaspiak Bat. Zaspiak Bat means the seven are one in the Basque language, and what that refers to are the seven provinces between Spain and France. There are three on the French side and four on the Spanish side. This single movement piano concerto would have seven movements, each movement drawing a folk theme from each of the seven provinces. It's a wonderful idea. Ravel had grown up as a child there in Saint-Jean-de-Luz, and his parents moved to Paris. Nevertheless, he always felt very close to Saint-Jean-de-Luz, particularly because his mother was a Spanish Basque, and she sang folk tunes to him when he was a little boy. One in particular called the Guajiras, which is a particular Basque tune that has an irregular rhythm, as also the Arafusa, which means the unsuccessful serenade. These folk tunes are comprised of groups of three plus two plus three. Later in his life, Ravel was interviewed for an autobiographical sketch, which has been published and is referred to many times in his biographies. He didn't really want to write anything himself, so he consented to be interviewed by his good friend Roland Manuel. And in that autobiographical sketch, you can almost tell what are the questions that Roland Manuel posed to Ravel, one about each of his famous pieces. And when he spoke of the trio, he called it Basque in color. And that's particularly evident in the first movement. The first movement's theme has the remnants of Zaspiak Bat, in that the theme is in 8/8 time. And you'll forgive me, those who aren't musicians, I know it's technical. I'm generally accustomed to not delivering such technical-oriented speeches, but this is a university after all, so you'll have to bear with all that stuff. 8/8 time is a little bit unusual for musicians, and in this particular case, it's 3 + 2 + 3. This Basque-influenced first theme is echoed in the themes of the other three movements of the trio as well. It's comprised of four movements total. The intervallic arrangement of all four of the main themes is strikingly similar. There's an initial whole step movement up or down, followed by the leap of a fourth or fifth. And I'd like to play now for you the main theme of each movement to show you how similar they are. Here's the theme of the first movement. I'm going to count the beats so you can feel that it's in 8. 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 1, 2, 1, 2, 3. Here's the second movement. Third movement. And fourth movement. So you can hear just how closely related they are. It's actually outlining a very closely pentatonic type melody. That's five tones. So we have a very unusual piece here, a piece whose harmony is centered around pentatonicism and whose rhythm is irregular groupings of threes and twos. For 1914, that's pretty avant-garde. Ravel knew instinctively that writing a piano trio would be a difficult endeavor because of the disparate sonorities of piano with two strings. Every major classical composer, Mozart, Beethoven, Schumann, Brahms, Mendelssohn, and even Chopin, wrote piano trios. And I think Ravel felt almost obligated to try his hand at this and wanted to make a significant statement. But as he quickly found out, it's very difficult to balance a 9-foot concert grand Steinway against two stringed instruments. He achieved balance in this work by putting the piano and the strings spaced 2 octaves apart, putting the piano line in between the two sets of strings. He also extensively explores the highest and lowest registers of all three instruments to create an illusion of orchestral sonority. This piece sounds as though it was written for symphony orchestra and reduced to just three instruments. He even borrowed from his own orchestration techniques, and he was a master orchestrator, by employing coloristic devices such as trills, tremolos, harmonics, and many glissandos throughout the trio. we hear these brilliant orchestral effects, particularly in the second and fourth movements. There's a lot of information about the trio contained in Ravel's correspondence. Thank goodness for us, he was a big letter and postcard writer. And many of those documents have been preserved, and many of them are right here at the Ransom Center. This was extremely interesting to read what he writes. He loves to send postcards out to his friends to let them know how he's doing on the compositions he's working on. One in particular to his friend and also a student of his, Maurice Delage. He said, "My trio is finished. Now I only need themes for it." This is one of Ravel's most revealing comments about his creative process, which was not unlike that of Mozart, a composer whom Ravel idolized. Both composers shared an ability to conceive of the entire structure of a work before putting a single note on paper. Ravel once explained his creative process, this again from the autobiographical sketch, and I quote, "In my own composition, I judge a long period of conscious gestation necessary. During this interval, I come progressively and with a growing precision to see the form and the evolution that the final work will take in its totality. Thus, I can be occupied for several years without writing a single note, after which, when I begin, the composition goes relatively quickly, but one must spend much time eliminating all that could be regarded as superfluous in order to realize as completely as possible the definitive clarity so much desired." On March 21st, 1914, he wrote to Madame Helen Casella. She's the wife of the famous Italian pianist and composer Alfredo Casella. In this letter, he describes his work habits in Saint-Jean-de-Luz that summer, and he writes, "I am working at the trio despite cold, storms, thunder, rain, and hail." Then later, he writes to his proofreader, Lucien Garbon, "Now it's 95 degrees outside, and for relief, I'm working on the trio and Zaspiak Bat, despite numerous diversions, Basque Pelota, which is a ball game, local fireworks, and toros de fuego, bullfighting, and other pyrotechnics. During most of the month of July, Ravel must have encountered a mental block, for he wrote again to Madame Casella, saying, despite fine weather now, the trio has not progressed for 3 weeks, and it disgusts me. But today, it didn't seem so loathsome. The carburetor is repaired." A few days after that, he wrote to Jacques Durand, his publisher in Paris, and said, "I'm continuing to work, still rather slowly, it's true, but more surely. I'm counting on the participation of the weather, which is turning fair again. This morning, I resumed my nautical pastimes, which I hope will stir up inspiration." Finally, his work did become compulsive. On August 3rd, he wrote to another friend, "I have never worked with more insane, heroic intensity." Then a few days later, back to his pupil, Maurice Delage, "I'm working on the trio with an insane certainty and lucidity, but I find myself sobbing over my sharps and flats." Obviously, he had an intense burst of creativity at this point. It was the beginning of August now. But the real reason for his sudden compulsion to complete the work was his desire to join the army. France had officially entered World War I on August 2nd, 1914. For Ravel, volunteering for military service had become a single-minded obsession. He felt a real great need to serve his country since he had been exempted from regular conscription at age 20 for health reasons. He also desperately wished to join his brother, Edward, and many, many of his friends who had already enlisted. But now he was 39 years old, and he had been refused because of medical authorities' repeated evaluations of his poor heart and below average weight. He tried to join the Air Force, hoping that his light weight would be an advantage for being in airplanes, but he was again rejected. But he finally did manage to obtain a post in the 13th Artillery Regiment as an ambulance driver, a post that of which he was very proud. He finished the trio with a burst of speed in order to volunteer and dashed off a letter to Igor Stravinsky, his good friend, from Saint-Jean-de-Luz. "Do let me have news of you. What is happening to you in the middle of all of this? Edward has joined up as a dispatch writer. I haven't been so lucky. They don't want me. But I'm pinning my hopes on the new medical examination that all of those who have been rejected will now pass, and on the strings that I may be able to pull. The idea that I should be leaving at once made me get through 5 months' work in just 5 weeks. My trio is now finished." Soon after, he wrote to Jacques Durand, his publisher, to tell him that the trio was ready and asking where he should send it. With the events of the time in mind, it's amazing that the work was completed in such a polished manner. When he sent the manuscript to Durand, publishers in Paris, it was accompanied by a set of specific notes regarding the printing of the proofs and the premiere performance. Ravel mentions these notes in three letters in September 1914. "Alas, your letter finds me still in Saint-Jean-de-Luz. The analysis of my trio, the notes for the correction of the proofs, and the performance in case I am absent, all of it is useless." Another letter, "I have drawn up a bunch of notes for the correction of the proofs and performance of my trio in case of the absence of the composer." And another, "Before going to Bayonne," that's a city north of Saint-Jean-de-Luz on the coast, "I spent 1 month working from morning till night without even taking time to bathe in the sea. I wanted to finish my trio, which I have treated as a posthumous work. That doesn't mean I have lavished genius on it, but that the order of my manuscript and the notes concerning it would allow anybody else to correct the proofs. It's all useless, however. The result will only be another trio." It's plain from these important words that Ravel knew very well that his publisher and engraver were capable of making grave mistakes in the printing of his works. No doubt they had done so many times before. He knew that with a complex work like the trio, that there were going to be serious problems having it published. There are an enormous amount of details, extended instrumental techniques for the time, avant-garde style, and unusual types of notation that were bound to cause the engravers many problems. While recuperating in an army hospital during the war, he wrote to his proofreader, Lucien Garbon. This is now in 1916, 2 years later. Garbon was preparing a piano duet transcription of this work for piano four hands, and Ravel wrote to him and said, "The detail of your present occupation impresses me. I had difficulty writing my trio. At least, please don't change the harmonies. I hope in about 2 weeks I will be able to surprise you in Paris with scalpel in hand, and that there will still be enough time to save some pieces of my poor trio." An amusing and revealing anecdote demonstrates how these errors in engraving and typesetting could be overlooked for years. While visiting England in 1928, Ravel gave a piano lesson on his sonatine to an English pianist named Gordon Bryan, who later wrote of the lesson. The sonatine for piano was published by Durand in 1905, and 23 years later, two accidentals were still missing in the last movement on bars 13 and 15, where there should be sharps before the D's in the bass. Ravel was disgusted beyond measure when I pointed this out to him, and he immediately sat down to write a letter to Durand, which by now must have burnt a hole in their files. He alluded to this several times later with a satisfied grin, and it appealed to his sense of humor that he should have to come all the way to England to be told of this horror. What's unusual about the Ravel trio is that his 1914 manuscript and the 1915 Durand edition differ so much, especially in the second movement. Respected Ravel scholar Arby Orenstein has closely studied all of Ravel's works and says, "Ravel's autographs and sketches bear witness to his relentless inner drive towards technical perfection. Rather than correct some minuscule details, he would frequently recopy an entire autograph. Ravel's battles against errors in notation were incessant, and he continued to make corrections in his scores even after they had been published. Many of his sketches are similar or even identical to their printed versions. For him, there was but one final product, the one which was as perfect as he could make it. The fact that there are differences between the manuscript and the Durand edition raises the inevitable questions of why there are any and how they came to exist. Did this manuscript serve as the basis for the Durand edition, or was another autograph copy used? Did Ravel proof a first edition and make revisions himself, or did someone else? Did he approve of the changes made to the work? A search for answers to these questions can be found in reading his personal letters, investigating important events of the period, and reviewing historical information presented in his biographies. If he were in such a hurry to enlist for the army, as he mentioned, he surely would not have had time to write out another 39-page manuscript. That's how long this piece is. If he did, it certainly would not have been a neat one. And the Ransom Center manuscript is eminently well-organized, neat, and very easy to read. Ravel and Mozart evidently had quite a bit in common in their precise handwriting and creative process. There are just a handful of strikeouts and only a handful of erasures in the score. Ravel did not include separate parts for the violin and cello, as he did for some of his other chamber works, because there was simply not time in the fall of 1914 for such labor. The premier performance of the Ravel trio took place at a recital of the Independent Music Society in the Salle Gaveau in Paris on January 28, 1915, but went virtually unnoticed by the public and press because of the war. The premiere was performed before a small audience by well-known and respected artists of the time, namely pianist Alfredo Casella, violinist Gabriel Villaume, and cellist Louis Feuillard. As I mentioned previously, Ravel wrote to Jacques Durand in August to advise that the trio was finished and asked where it should be sent. The Durand copyright on the trio is 1915, not 1914, meaning that it's very likely it was published after the January 1915 premiere. Accordingly, it's possible that the first performers of this work, Casella, Villaume, and Feuillard, became its first editors. These performers probably used a preliminary proof printing, since there were no separate manuscript string parts written out by Ravel to play from. Thus, their rehearsal and performance markings, additions, and deletions could easily have been incorporated into the final Durand edition. A close comparison of the manuscript with the Durand edition reveals that large sections of the second movement, Pantoum, have been completely rewritten. Specifically, difficult triplet passage work in the string parts has been transferred to the piano part. Perhaps violinist Villaume and cellist Feuillard complained that the music was too difficult to play. I theorize that Alfredo Casella, who was a virtuoso pianist and composer, recomposed these sections in the Pantoum. In Casella's autobiography called Music in My Time, he relates the following extremely important information about the trio's premier performance, the abilities of the string players, and his involvement with its final publication. And I quote, "In the autumn of 1914, Ravel had finished his trio. He wanted to have it performed publicly, but in those first anguished months of the war, there was no possibility for a concert. However, a relative calm returned to the capital after the victory at Marne, and I had the idea of giving a benefit concert for the war, which could include this very important first performance. It took place on January 28, 1915, in the Salle Gaveau, and had to be given at 7 p.m., since all public transportation ceased at 10 o'clock. I played the trio with two mediocre performers. Although we had about 20 rehearsals, they still managed to achieve several blunders. Nevertheless, the piece was very successful, and the proceeds of this first chamber concert to be given in Paris during the war were quite encouraging. Ravel was very grateful to me and wished me to correct the proofs of the work. Unfortunately, there are no remaining sketches or corrected proofs to consult, nor, unfortunately, any personal correspondence to refute or support my theory. Musicians in Beethoven's era complained regularly that his music was impossibly difficult to perform, and certainly the same was said of Ravel's music. However, today's standard of technical virtuosity is much higher than 100 years ago. The challenges posed by the original version of the Pantoum, while still formidable, are not insurmountable. My new Masters Music Publications edition of the Ravel Trio includes two versions of the Pantoum movement. The original version, according to Ravel's 1914 manuscript, and a corrected and edited version of the anonymously revised 1915 Durand edition. I feel it's impossible to ignore 93 years of tradition of performing the Pantoum according to the Durand edition. So I got permission to include it in my new edition, so there are actually five movements total. We know that Ravel attended at least three performances of the trio after the war, so obviously he would have heard this revision. The second version here, though, is not simply a reprint of the original Durand edition. I have corrected Durand's printing errors, transferred some missing indications from the manuscript, and included some editorial suggestions. Performers now have the option of choosing which version they prefer to perform. Ravel's biographers are unanimous in observing the extreme care he gave to all aspects of his works. One points out he was extremely meticulous about every tempo and dynamic marking in his works. A deliberate alteration in a score was a major calamity. For Ravel, precision in everything, especially in music, was all important, and his scores are marked in such a way as to leave no room for doubt about his intentions. Another wrote, his passion was to offer the public works which were finished and polished to the ultimate degree. However, he mentions in a letter to a friend about his disdain for proofing his works. My work now? It's a nasty job. I am correcting the proofs of L'Enfant et les Sortilèges. That's one of his two operas. Although reviewed by a lot of people, there still remain 10 corrections per page. The Durand edition of the Ravel Trio contains just about as many errors per page as did L'Enfant et les Sortilèges. When Ravel attended the Paris Conservatory at age 16, he received his first prize in piano performance, not in composition. He studied and performed a great deal of virtuoso piano solo repertoire over the course of his 6 years of study at the Conservatoire. Thus, he really understood the technical capabilities of the piano from the inside out. According to his close friend and fellow pianist Louis Aubert, he said, there was no instrument that Ravel had not studied as thoroughly as was possible. He pursued this knowledge with the single-mindedness of a man totally possessed by an exclusive passion. Another biographer says, the only reproach that could be leveled against Ravel's trio is its excessive difficulty, which makes it almost impossible for amateurs to perform. His good friend, violinist Helen Jourdan-Morhange, complained to Ravel when she and a cellist were rehearsing his sonata for violin and cello. It's just too complicated. It must be great fun writing such difficult stuff, but no one's going to be able to play it except virtuosos. Ravel responded to her in kind by letter, good, then I won't be assassinated by amateurs. Madame Jourdan-Morhange also noted that, in general, Ravel found that performers did not read the instructions on his scores carefully enough, and that everything to do with technique interested him, and he wanted to know the violin's most extreme capabilities. I've seen letters that Ravel wrote to her, and he would draw musical staff in the letter and write some terribly difficult passage and write underneath, is this possible? In other words, Ravel knew exactly what he was asking from his performers when he composed. Whether they were always able to perform his difficult music is an entirely different matter. His self-professed compositional motto was complex, but not complicated. Even today, Ravel's music still poses formidable challenges for the most talented student and artist performers. He was adamant that performers closely follow the indications he put in his scores. He complained vociferously about pianist Ricardo Vignes, Marguerite Long, Alfred Cortot, and Paul Wittgenstein's interpretational liberties with his music. These were among the leading French musicians of the day, and they were all close friends with Ravel, and his disagreements with them sometimes severely strained their loyal friendships. Violinist André Asselin recalls Ravel saying, "With regard to the performer, his task is never to forget that the line between the letter and the spirit of a work is very narrow and must remain so." His critic and close friend Emile Vermoz said, "Debussy's writing calls for the cooperation of an active sensibility. Ravel only asks for a respectful attention. There are many ways of playing Debussy, but there is only one way to play Ravel." Marguerite Long recalls Ravel saying, "Performers are slaves, and that music should be created for music's sake and not for the sake of the players." I believe that these honest and revealing comments, coupled with the extraordinary technical abilities of today's musicians, warrant publication of an edition that reflects Ravel's original conception and respects his ingenuity. Understandably, these restorations will affect the performance of the work, sometimes in radical ways and sometimes only in minor ways. Now I'd like to speak a little bit about, briefly about some analysis of the work. And I'd like to quote Ravel. "Real art, I repeat, is not to be recognized by definitions, nor revealed by analysis. We sense its manifestations and feel its presence. It's apprehended in no other way." So, having said that, now I'm going to give you an analysis, much to his consternation, I'm sure. His music is so frequently appealing to the ear that a listener can be completely unaware of what the basic architectural underpinnings are. And this is probably how Ravel would have wanted his works appreciated. He delighted in veiling his craft in secrecy and destroyed countless drafts and sketches. Everything in his music seems to evolve naturally out of previous material and just grow phrase by phrase. One of the main differences between the manuscript and the Durand edition is an abundance of misplaced, missing, or unnecessary double bar lines. The correct positioning of these double bar lines, or their removal in some cases, serves to delineate Ravel's purposely obscured structures in the first, second, and fourth movements of the trio. Ravel was very particular about his use of double bar lines. He did not normally use them to mark key changes, but rather employed them to delineate structural events. The first and fourth movement of the trio are constructed in a modified sonata allegro form. In these two movements, the lines of division between exposition, development, and recapitulation are difficult to assess because of the organic nature of the music, and because the first and last movements contain false or imitated recapitulations. Ravel took great delight in this technique. We know he was quite fond of Mendelssohn's violin concerto. At the end of that work, in the violin's cadenza, the orchestral recapitulation begins before the violin is finished, thus blurring the lines of demarcation. Only in retrospect does one understand what Mendelssohn has achieved. Ravel employs a similar technique in the first and last movements of the trio. And in my new edition, I have restored the original double bar lines as I found them in the manuscript. So now musicians can more easily perceive the structure of these two movements. As Ornstein noted, Ravel attached great importance to such small details, for no aspect of his craft was too small to be given his fullest attention. The unusual second movement, entitled Pontum, is based on a poetic form of the same name, which comes from Malay descent. Many of Ravel's biographers point out that both Verlaine and Baudelaire wrote poems based on the pontum form. the most famous of which is Baudelaire's Harmonie du Soir, which Debussy famously set to music in 1887. We know that Ravel was a great admirer of Baudelaire, so it is not impossible that this particular poem, and perhaps also Debussy's song, was an influence for the composition of this pontoum. The chief characteristic of a pontoum is the duality of themes in constant alternation. As a result, there are two separate yet related poems joined together through an elaborate system of line rotation. An essential feature is that the second and fourth lines of each stanza become the first and third lines of the following stanza, interlinked. Also, the first line of the entire poem must return as the last line of the poem. The poem treats two themes, one of which serves as an accompaniment to the other. The rhyme at the end of the first line returns at the end to unify and frame the poem. Of course, Ravel couldn't employ a rhyme scheme, so he only uses the alternating double theme in his pontoum. But as though this one task were not enough, Ravel also constructs this entire procedure within a classical scherzo and trio form. If taken apart, all the various iterations of the two separate themes could theoretically be connected together and played as separate units. The trio section is an incredibly complex structure that somehow brings together continued alternations of the two themes while introducing a new trio theme of a completely different character. It almost sounds like cafe music of the 1920s. It's sort of a hymn-like chorale with a jazz twist. It's very similar to the minuet in the Le Tombeau de Couperin. In this trio section, Ravel juxtaposes 4-2 and 3-4 time signatures simultaneously, and then halfway through, inverts the two sound blocks between the instrument groups. His ability to create symmetry out of such completely different textures and melodies and achieve balance between the instrumental forces is almost superhuman. The music never sounds complicated, even if it is extremely difficult to coordinate among the players. The third movement is a passacaglia. It's a straightforward arch shape constructed out of 11 8-measure blocks of music. There are only minor typographical corrections to the original Durand edition, so there are no significant revelations structurally. However, I have managed to unlock the mystery of the strange harmonic structure that has remained unexplained for nearly a century. Ravel's passacaglia movement is not actually a true Baroque passacaglia, which traditionally is a set of variations over a repeated bass melody. This is different from a chaconne, which employs a repeated chord sequence rather than a repeated melody. The bass melody of Ravel's passacaglia is constantly modified through its repetitions. First, the piano states it very low in the bass, then the cello repeats the melody, and finally, the violin. When the violin's entry occurs, the melody begins to evolve. It does not actually return to its original form until the end of the movement. Oddly, Ravel notated his passacaglia using the key signature of F sharp minor, which has three sharps. However, the passacaglia melody presented first by the piano is actually C sharp minor centered pentatonic. C sharp minor uses four sharps in its key signature. So why didn't Ravel compose the work using that key signature? If the melody were transposed up a whole step to G sharp minor, the melody would begin on D sharp and use all five black piano keys. If it were transposed to A minor, it would begin on E and use five white piano keys. And now I'd like to demonstrate that for you. Here's the original in F sharp. If it were transposed up a step to G sharp minor, it would sound like this on all the black keys. And if it were transposed up another step to A minor, it would use five white piano keys. An antique feeling permeates the melody owing to its modal outline, but at first Ravel purposely leaves ambiguous which minor mode he will utilize by delaying the introduction of the sixth and seventh tones of the scale. At the beginning, it's only pentatonic. There are only five tones in the melody. Aeolian, Dorian, and Phrygian modes all have a minor third between the tonic and third degree and thus closely resemble minor mode. At rehearsal one, an A natural first appears in the piano accompaniment to the cello's entrance. This now adds a sixth tone to the pentatonic scale and narrows the possibilities either to Aeolian or Phrygian. The final outcome depending upon the inclusion of either a D natural or a D sharp. Finally, at rehearsal two, when the violin enters, Ravel introduces a D natural in the piano accompaniment and resolves the mystery. Our mode is C sharp Phrygian. C sharp, D, E, F sharp, G sharp, A, B, C sharp. And as if to reinforce the lowered second degree of Phrygian modality, the final cadence in the piano contains D, A, resolving to C sharp, G sharp. And to further accentuate the antique modal nature, Ravel purposely includes no third degree in the final chord. I'd now like to introduce two fine musicians who have volunteered to perform tonight for you. They are really extraordinary. Many of you know Daniel Ching, the first violinist of the Miro String Quartet, and Amy Levine Sang, the cellist of the Laurel Piano Trio. I couldn't believe my luck when they agreed to do this performance. They are both very busy musicians, and they've spent hours practicing. They each have played this piece many times in their careers, especially Amy being part of a piano trio. Every preformed piano trio plays the Ravel trio, so she knows this piece inside and out, and Daniel's played it many times throughout his career. So I'd like to welcome them to the stage now. According to French pianist Alfred Cortot, who was a close friend of Ravel, Ravel used to say, "I don't want my music to be interpreted. Merely to play it is sufficient." Could you please turn to the page in your program that shows the facsimile reproduction of the first page of the first movement of Ravel's manuscript of the trio? You'll have to put on your microscope to read it. For those who are musicians, you'll be able to barely discern that underneath the first measure of the piano part, the violin and cello are tacit or silent for the first measure. You'll notice under the piano part that there's a pedal indication directly beneath the first beat in the first measure. In the Durand edition, this is printed one beat later. I don't know if that's a misprint or if that was Casella who moved it, But in any case, this poses an interesting interpretive question about the staccato on the first chord of the first beat. The character of the theme can be significantly influenced and modified by the use or the avoidance of pedal on the first beat. It's a debatable question of musical taste, and I leave it to the pianist's judgment to decide for him or herself how best to interpret it. So I'd like to play for you the two different ways that this can affect the main theme of this piece. First, with the pedal on the second beat, which will make the first note rather dry, and then we'll play it with the pedal on the first beat. Pedal on the downbeat. Impressionistic, colorful, and smooth. There's so many ways to describe it. So naturally, I prefer the manuscript version. And I think that's really how most people have played it over the past 93 years. I've listened to dozens of recordings of this piece, and I can only think of one that emphasizes that staccato. So it's, I think musicians have instinctively thought that that was a misprint, and it's nice to know that Ravel put it right there on the downbeat. The next major difference between the manuscript and the Durand edition is the alignment of downbeat whole notes with the first note of piano's arpeggiations. Ravel marked this very clearly in his manuscript. Originally, he marked whole notes in the string parts above the piano arpeggiation, directly above the first note of the arpeggio, and tied those string whole notes to another note directly above the post-arpeggio downbeat, but changed his mind and erased the extra note and rewrote a single whole note appearing at the very beginning of each measure. By the term erased, I actually mean that Ravel literally scraped the ink off of the music paper, there being no other way to remove the errors. He did this frequently throughout the work, most probably using a razor blade. He carefully redrew the staff lines each time, since they also became erased during this surgical procedure. But fortunately, the original ink stains were not completely removed, and it's quite easy to see what were his first intentions. It's almost like being an archaeologist. And the Ransom Center reading room very gratefully provides us a big magnifying glass. Ravel obviously wanted to continue this same musical gesture throughout the movement. He was extraordinarily precise in his intentions. This same gesture is repeated 12 times in other similar passages in the first movement, once in the third movement, and twice in the fourth movement. In each instance, the string players should hold their downbeat notes while the pianist gracefully plays the arpeggio on the downbeat, rather than hurriedly squeezing in all of the arpeggio notes before the downbeat as it's printed in the Durand edition. The first time I learned this piece, I felt frantic every time I got to that section, always trying to catch up with them. So it's nice to see that that this is not just a mistake, that he was very precise every time. He gave specific instructions on, in the very first iteration of this passage, and how this is to be performed. The strings' downbeat notes have fermati. A fermata means a hold. Fermati placed directly above them and are aligned precisely with the first note of the piano arpeggio. And now we're going to demonstrate what that sounds like. Just so much nicer not to have to rush that. Oh. As I mentioned previously, Ravel greatly admired Mendelssohn and Mozart. In fact, he produced a critical edition of Mendelssohn's complete piano solo works for Durand. In Mendelssohn's piano trio in D minor, I found the exact same gesture of strings playing a sustained note simultaneously with the first note of the piano's arpeggio. In measures 86 and 87 of the first movement, Ravel very carefully marked a tiny tie between the lower dotted quarter note D natural on the downbeat and the first D natural of the left-hand melody line. That's complicated to understand, I know. The Durand edition overlooks this small but important tie. The effect of tying the notes together, and thus not replaying the D natural, prevents the strings from having to hold their already long chord another eighth note's worth of time. They already must sustain for five beats, not including the extra time to accommodate the arpeggio on the downbeat. This detail is important since string players have to carefully meter their bows on long held notes such as this. But more importantly, the forward momentum of the music, even at a slow tempo, is better maintained when the tie is observed. Thank you. I'm speaking of here is in this arpeggio. It's written like this in the Durand version. And in the manuscript, it's written much more elegantly with the tie. Seems like a minor detail, but when you're up here doing battle, that makes a big difference. Next, I'd like to point out at the very end of the movement, and this is not really a difference between the manuscript and the Durand edition. Being an editor now, in addition to a performer, I've used what I've learned as a performer to guide me as an editor. That's only natural, of course. But in listening to the various recordings of the Ravel Trio, one day I almost fell off the piano bench. Probably my favorite recording is Yasha Heifetz, Gregor Piatigorsky, and Arthur Rubinstein. It's the classic 1950 RCA recording. I had listened to it many, many times, but had the score in my hands and was really listening to it critically and watching what was happening. At the end of the first movement, there's a very long, sustained passage where we hear the 3+2+3 rhythm in the left hand. And the piano's final note are two whole notes on spaces in the staff, the top two spaces of the staff. And Arthur Rubinstein misread it as a bass clef and ends like this on the recording. And then Piatigorsky plays at the end, the way it's marked. Actually, it's supposed to be in the treble clef. I couldn't believe my ears. This, of course, was in the days before you could cut and splice, but I think you actually could back in 1950, that even the producer didn't catch it. It just simply happens to be a coincidence that the two top spaces of either the treble or the bass clef form are the pitches of a C major chord. So that's why he made the mistake. It sounded okay. So I've added a redundant treble clef just before the final note, so that nobody else makes that mistake. And how can I prove that that is really treble clef and not bass clef? Because I had a Debussy scholar challenge me on this very issue. Lucien Garbon, the proofreader I referred to earlier in the lecture, who had written to Ravel asking his permission to make the piano duet transcription for four hands. Well, I finally managed to track down that transcription for piano duet. And of course, he would have had to have decided whether or not it was in the bass or the treble. And I'm happy to report it's the treble. So I let that musicologist know that I was right. Now on to the pontoon movement. This is the part that's really quite shocking from a performer's standpoint. I hope you'll be able to hear this. We're going to skip directly to the parts that are very different. At rehearsal two, first I'll play just the piano solo part by itself, and then with the strings. This is the Durand edition. Triplets all in the right hand, and it's very difficult to play. Here's what Ravel originally wrote. Basically, just all solid chords, and I miss many fewer notes when I only have to play the chords and not the triplets. But guess who gets to play the triplets? They do. So You can just imagine that cellist Louis Feuillard and violinist Gabriel Villaume said, uh-uh, there's no way I'm playing that. So now we'd like to play for you so you can hear the string parts. This is what's been in the Durand edition and what all violinists and cellists are accustomed to playing. They still play triplets. Daniel, could you just demonstrate how easy it is to play these triplets? Thanks. It's really repeated notes within each triplet. Now we're going to play according to what Ravel originally wrote, which is basically big arpeggios all over the place. Trying a little bit of that, just a couple of measures so they can hear the difference. That's enough torture. It's really hard. Really hard. Now, skipping to the end of this movement, the other major difference, and there are many differences, I'm just hitting the big ones here. The big difference at the very end of this movement is right at the climax, where the strings jump up to a very high pianissimo, very, very high. It's a very difficult leap to accomplish. It comes right after a fortissimo passage, and it's a sudden subito pianissimo. In the Durand edition, Casella, as again, it was my theory that Casella adds a measure of 1/4 time. He adds one beat and puts a rest in the string parts and breaks the octave, the low octave in the piano, in order to give them time to get up there. And it's very helpful, but now I will tell you that after we've rehearsed for a couple of days, when we play the Durand edition with the extra beat, they say, oh my goodness, it seems so easy now. But it wasn't impossible to play. As you'll hear, they do just fine. So first is the, here's the Durand edition with the extra beat. Here's without the extra beat. I hope you can hear that. They certainly know that the extra beat is there when they go up for that high, screechy stuff. Also, what's interesting is in the very last two measures of the piano part, Casella being a virtuoso pianist, and I will admit that Ravel was not a virtuoso pianist, even though he was a very good pianist, the original pattern of the last two notes, the last two measures of the piano part are this. Here's Casella's revision, which is easy to play. And Ravel originally wrote, which requires me to jump. It's much more awkward. They sound pretty similar. Also, what's interesting is in the left hand, the final chords of the Durand edition are a tonic chord, but Ravel put it in first inversion, so we get two C sharps. I think that's more elegant because the two strings both play A on the last note. We have a low A in the bass. If we use a tonic chord, we only have one C sharp. So there's not enough thirds to the chord. I don't understand why Casella would have changed that. it just makes better sense the way Ravel originally did it. In the fourth movement of the Ravel trio, there is no specific tempo marking at the top of the manuscript. Simply, the metronome mark, quarter note equals 1:52. Well, that may seem a little bit strange. Most composers put allegro or vivace, prestissimo, some kind of Italian designation, but they don't just put a naked metronome mark. I think that that was done on purpose. Igor Stravinsky, who was Ravel's good friend, has many examples in his works where movements only have a metronome mark and there's no title. Ravel did give this movement a title at the top. It just says finale in French, which means finale. And everybody knows a finale is going to be fast, so I think he thought it's just redundant. But I think the Durand engravers couldn't resist fixing it. So what they did was they looked ahead in the piece at measure 31, where there's the first tempo change. It's, Ravel writes, moins animé, less animated. And then 10 measures later, tempo one, but a little less animated. Premier mouvement, un peu moins animé. Thus implying that the beginning was indeed animé. So I think that that's why I've included it in parenthesis on your program. You see the fourth movement says finale, and then in parenthesis, animé. It's not really there. I'd like to play for you something I discovered in the manuscript of the fourth movement. The very first measure, and this is how I know that this was the true autograph that was used for the printing and not a sketch. In the very first measure of the last movement, Ravel originally wrote an A major chord, whole notes, underneath the string's bowings. And then he used his razor blade and scraped it all off and changed his mind. And of course, that was how it was printed. If he had rewritten the trio, he certainly would not have made that mistake again. And it's a very deliberate erasure there. It's so easy to see. So I'd like to, just for theoretical sake, to hear what Ravel first conceived of the beginning of the fourth movement. It's interesting to hear how a composer has changed his mind. Today, with computers, everything gets erased and you don't get to see any mind changing. Here's the way he originally conceived it. There's this chord at the beginning. Now, this is how it was printed and how he wanted it, since he erased it. It's just very interesting to hear the difference. You can now, we don't need that A major chord. I agree with him. Now, jumping on to the end of this movement, I'm going to torture poor Amy and Daniel here and ask them to play two examples of what Casella rewrote, probably because there were too many complaints from Feuillard and from Villaume. These are near the end. There are two sets, this is at the climax of the piece, two sets of these big trills and triplets. First, the Durand edition, the cheap and easy way of playing it. Pretty easy. Now let's hear how Ravel originally conceived it. If you hear that, you hear there's a lot more work involved. It's much, much more difficult, but they do it just great. And it sounds very much like the Ravel Tzigan. It's the same kind of harmonics and jumping around the instruments. Ravel really pushed the boundaries, really pushed the limits of technique, and really made his players work. And then finally, the closing measures. The strings have been completely rewritten here. The cello has really just a tremolo on E and A, but Ravel's original way was a complete chord, mimicking what was at the beginning. And the violin is on a high trill. So can we hear the Durand revision, please? And now the way Ravel originally conceived it. Notice how the end is stronger. First of all, Amy's playing a full chord tremolo, so that sounds better because we get the third of the chord. But at the very end, it's stronger because Ravel has deleted ties that were in... Ravel did not include the ties that are in the Durand edition, which means that the players are supposed to play a new note on the final chord. And oddly enough, that's how most players have been playing it for the past 93 years. They just ignore those Durand ties. So again, it's really nice to know that their instincts have been correct all this time. Well, that has hit the highlights of the big differences between the two. There are literally thousands of these changes, big and small, in these four movements. The piece takes about 25 minutes to perform, and so now we're going to start from beginning to end and play the re-world premiere the way it was heard on January 28th, 1915 in Paris. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you.
Thank you. I'd like to say just thanks to a few people who've helped me these past 20 years. First, my doctoral committee, Dr. John Grubbs, the late Amanda Vick Lethko, Dr. Jane Lipman, Betty Mallard, David Renner, and David Ashley White. I'd also like to thank the librarian curators at the Harry Ransom Center, specifically Kathy Henderson, Del Hollingsworth, and most especially Richard Workman for their assistance. I'd also like to thank my editor-in-chief at Masters Music Publications, Clark McAllister, and the owner of the company, Leon Gallison, for agreeing to publish this special edition, which will make no money for them. To my engraver, Giuliano Forghieri, in Italy, whom I've never met, I offer my gratitude for his precision and patience with a seemingly endless number of tiny details. I think Ravel would be pleased. I'd also like to thank especially the following family members, personal friends, musicians, and scholars for their generous support of, enthusiastic interest in, and kind assistance with this project over the past 20 years. My aunt and uncle, Jean and Robert Ball, my cousins, Judith and James Caffrey, pianist Andrew Cooperstock, James Davis, a French scholar, my parents, who are now deceased, cellist Evan Drachman, my high school piano teacher, Madge Hunt, my adopted musical parents, Joan and Al Landry, my sister and brother-in-law, Trey and Melissa LaRoe, pianist Eliane Lossad, my partner and page turner, James Lee, my former teacher, Martha McDonald, and her husband, Robert, Keith Meinhold, who designed the beautiful cover, Ravel scholar R.B. Orenstein, who provided much advice, my old teacher at Yale, Joan Panetti, and the two string players with whom I performed this piece as a student, Stephen Pelkey and Stefan Teason, to my proofing assistants, Anne and Isidore Sasloff, my teacher, Abby Simon, to Ruth and John Tom Forty, Chip Zoller, Robert Zoschke, and finally my friends here in Austin who've housed me many times during my research episodes, Brian Vodica and Stephen Aubrey. Thank you all very, very much, and good night.